Common indices 2, lecture 4 is raw materials of soap and detergents. The table of contents of this lecture are soap manufacturing processes and products, raw materials, alkali, fats and oils, optical brighteners, spray string or chelating agents, and abrasives. So in this lecture, you will learn how we can manufacture the soap, which processes are involved for making the soaps, and in manufacturing soaps, which type of products we can obtain, and what types of raw material which are involved for making the soap. So major raw material which involved for making the soap is alkali. Alkali is a major component for soap making. You can take sodium hydroxide or potassium hydroxide as an alkali and add it into the fats and oils. The fats and oils are the second most important component of soap making. You can take fats and oils from animals or vegetable fats and from fatty acids. After this, the optical brighteners are added in the soaps. What is the major function of acting? Adding optical brighteners in the soap, their major function for adding in the soap to make the clothing appear whiter and brighter and thus clear. They are modern day replacement for decades old practice of doing. They can be added in a small amount of blue dye to fabric to make it appear whiter. After this, we can add sequestering or chelating agents in the soap. The sequestering or chelating agents are used to eliminate the water hardness in heavy metals such as iron and copper, which are affect the scoring process. The agents bind the polyvalent cations such as calcium and magnesium in water and in fibers, thus preventing the precipitation of soap. So after this, we can add abrasives in the soap. So what is the major function of adding abrasive in the soaps? They can be added in the soap to effectively remove the heavy metals, tough embedded greases, oil, adhesives, cutting oils, and dirt. These smooth, fine scrubbers provide a gentle cleaning assistant and fast acting cleaning power to remove the toughest dirt and contamination in the soap. Manufacturing processes and products. So in this slide you can learn how we can manufacture the soap. So there are two processes which involve for the manufacturing of soap. The first process you can see hot caustic alkali solution such as caustic soda, sodium hydroxide, which can act as natural fats or oil such as tallow or vegetable oil to produce the sodium fatty acid salt, soap and glycine or glycerol. This bonification reaction is the basis of all soap making. So in the first process, what we need natural fats or oil such as hot caustic alkali solution, tallow or vegetable oil to produce the soap by the process of spoonification. So what are tallows? You can take an example of beef or mutton fat as tallows that are made up of triglycerides that are solid at room temperature, or they do not reach refrigeration process. We can keep it in a container to prevent the oxidation. So what are vegetable oils? Vegetable oils or vegetable fats can be extracted from seeds or from the parts of foods. These are like animal fats or vegetable fats, or the mixture of triglycerides You can take an example of vegetable fats or vegetable oils as soybean oils and cocoa butter. So in the first process, the soap making process involves the spoonification process. So in spoonification process, what we need fats and oil that are converted into soap by the presence of alkali solution, and in this process we provide heat to our solution. So in the first process, the whole soap making process involves the spoonification process, and what we need reactant as fats or oils that produce the product as sodium fatty acid salt, soap, and glycine or glycerol. By choosing the hot caustic alkali solution or caustic soda, sodium hydroxide. So in the second process, how we can produce industrially the soap? You can see if industry produce fatty acids are used in place of natural fats or oil, the reaction with caustic soda yield soap and water instead of soap and glycerin. So in industry, we need fatty acids instead of natural fats and oil for the manufacturing of soap and water. So these are two processes which are involved for the manufacturing of soap materials. So instead of the basic chemical reaction for the making of soap and detergents, there are some raw materials which are involved for the manufacturing of soap and detergents. So what are raw materials which are involved for the manufacturing of detergents? The fatty alcohols are important raw materials which are used for the manufacturing of anionic synthetic detergents. You can take an example of anionic detergents as sodium chloride sulfate and sodium and rhodicyl benzene sulfonates, and typical anionic detergents are alkyl benzene sulfonates. So why we can call them as anionic detergents? Because the alkyl benzene portion of this anion is lipophilic and the sulfonate portion is hydrophilic. Okay, these are largely used in our society, and because these are poorly biodegradable, an estimated amount of 16 billion kilograms of anionic detergents are produced annually for our domestic markets. So there are some natural anionic detergents which are produced by our liver to aid the digestion and absorption of fats and oil. So these natural anionic detergents are bilaces such as deoxycholic acids. So in the second part, you can see what are the raw materials which are used for the manufacturing of soap. The major raw materials for soap manufacturing are fats and alkali. Other raw materials include optical brighteners, water softeners, and abrasives are often added to obtain the specific characteristics. So there are some additives that are added to the soap to obtain the specific characteristics, their specific order, etc. So these are the raw materials which are involved for the manufacturing of soap and detergents. Alkali. So alkali is a major substance which is involved for the production of soap. You can take an example of alkali as sodium hydroxide and potassium hydroxide such as caustic potash. So the production of soap involves the spoonification process. What is the use of alkali in spoonification process? we can take fats and oil, and by using the alkali we can convert into the soap. So in the first point you can see that sodium hydroxide is employed as a spunification alkali for most soap now produced. Soap may also be manufactured with potassium hydroxide caustic potash as an alkali. So in the first point you can understand that it is not necessary that we can choose sodium hydroxide as an alkali in the manufacturing of soap. You can also use the sodium hydroxide caustic potash for the manufacturing of soap. Or sodium hydroxide can also be called as spunification alkali, and that are mostly produced. In second point, you can see that potassium soaps are more soluble in water than sodium soap. In concentrated form, they are called as soft soap. Although soft soaps are declining in importance, potassium soap is still produced in various liquid concentration for use in combination with sodium soap in shaving products and in textile industry. So in second point, you can understand that the potassium soaps are more soluble in water than sodium soap. Why? Because the potassium soaps contain the larger amount of water. That's why we can call as soft soaps, or these are more softer. And the soft soaps are declining in importance, but potassium soap is still produced in various liquid concentration in the combination with sodium soap. So what we do in shaving products or in our textile industries, we can use sodium soap and potassium soap both together for the making of shaving products and other products in the textile industries. So in the third point, you can see that certain alkaline materials builders are almost universally present in laundry soaps, functioning to increase detergency. The most important are sodium silicate water glass, sodium carbonate soda ash, sodium perborate, and various phosphates. So in detergents, you can see that alkaline materials such as builders are used. So what are these type of alkaline materials or alkaline builders? The alkaline materials or alkaline builders increase the pH or alkalinity of cleaning products. So it is important to note that you cannot choose or you cannot relate the alkalinity or pH together. These both are different terms. The pH and alkalinity are different terms. So you can take an example of alkaline cleansing agent as bleach, which contains the pH of about 12, and ammonia, which can contain the pH of about 11. These are the important alkaline cleaning agent. Okay, that prevent the redeposition. They can dissolve the dirt. They can attack the rust. Or alkaline cleaners are dissolved in water. They can dissolve the fats, oils, and protein-based substances, and clean the cloths or whatever materials we want to clean. Fats and oils. Instead of alkali, the fatty raw materials are used for the manufacturing of soap. You can see in this slide that fatty raw materials for soap manufacture include animals and vegetable oils, and fats or fatty acids, as well as byproducts of cellulose and paper industry, such as rosin and toluene. Four groups of these raw materials can be distinguished according to the properties of soap products they yield. So there are fatty raw materials which are involved in the manufacturing of soap that include animals or vegetable oils, rosins, and toluene. And these raw materials can be distinguished into four types. First is slow leaching soaps. Hard fats yielding slow leaching soaps include tallow, hydrogenated high melting point margarine, and vegetable oils and palm oils. These fats yield soap. They produce little leather in cold water, more in warm water, are mild on skin, and cleans well. This is the leading group of fats used in international soap industry, with tallow the most important member. So you can see that it can be seen from its name that slow leathering soaps forms slow leathers when we use these type of soap with water. That forms slow leather in cold water, and when we use these type of soaps in warm water, that produce more leather as compared to the cold water. An important point is that their action on skin is mild. So when we using that type of soap, so they cleans well the skin and their action on skin is mild. Another important point is that these type of soaps are used largely in international industry, and it contain an important member such as tallow. What are tallow? The tallow consists of animal fats. And what are hydrogenated high melting point margarine? That are marine oils with iodine values over 140 and can be selectively hydrogenated to yield that type of oil. So when we use this type of soap, what action takes place in water? The interaction between soap bubbles pushes the water molecules away from each other and revealing the surface tension. So a soap bubble is just an air wrapped in a film that is made up of soap and water. The air bubbles are now trapped, and lots of trapped air bubbles covered in soap molecules are what we call soap lather. So that's how the soap lather is formed when we use in water these type of soaps. Second point is that hard fats yielding quick lathering soaps. So in second point you can see that hard fats yielding quick lathering soaps include coconut oil, palm kernel oil, oil palm. These fats are not very sensitive to electrolytes such as salts. Thus, they are suitable for the manufacturing of marine soap, where must they form leather in seawater. This is the second most important group of soap fat, with coconut oil most used. So the example of quick leathering soaps are coconut oil, palm kernel oil or oil palm, or they are used in the manufacturing of marine soap. You can see that the water of marine is very hot or hot water. So they does not even form quickly the leathers when they are used with water. So the quick leathering soap has the ability to form quick leathers when we are using in water these type of soaps. So after the slow leathering soaps, that are the second most important group of soap fats. Or in this type of soaps, the coconut oil is mostly used. Now you can differentiate between slow leaching soaps and quick leaching soaps. Third point is that all cheating soaps are soap consistency, such as olive oil, soybean oil, groundnut, peanut oil are most important here, and linseed and whale oil are also belong to the group, as do some semi-drying or drying oils, because these oils rarely undergo changes in air or light or during storage. Soaps made from them may become rancid and discolored. So the soft consistency soaps includes olive oil, soybean oil, peanut oil, linseed and whale oils, semi-drying and drying oils. You have studied semi-drying, non-drying and drying oils before. There is some sort of iodine number or iodine value is involved in drying oils, semi-drying oils and non-drying oils. So what are semi-drying oils? A semi-drying oil is an oil which partially hardens when it is exposed to air. This is opposed to the drying oil, which hardens completely when exposed to the air, or the non-drying oils, which does not harden at all when exposed to the air. So about 115 to 130 are considered as semi-drying oils with iodine values of such number. So a semi-drying oils have iodine number or iodine values are about 115 to 130. These types of oils have one disadvantage that they are rarely undergo changes in air, or they become rancid and discolored when they are exposed to the air. Number four point is that rosin and tall oil, a resinous byproduct of manufacture of chemical wood pulp, form a group in themselves. Rosin is used in laundry soap, less expensive toilet soaps, and especially soaps in various industries. Tall oil is mainly used in liquid soaps. You can take an example of tall oil rosins as they are the components of adhesives, rubbers, and inks, and used as an emulsifiers. Or you can take an example of oil-based varnishes as rosin tall oils. They have one advantage is that these types of soaps are less expensive, and these are used in laundry soaps, less expensive toilet soaps, and these are used in various type of industries. The main ingredient in rosin and tall oil is tall oil, which is used in the formation of liquid soap. So now you can understand the fatty raw materials which are involved in the manufacturing of soap. Optical brighteners. So what are optical brighteners and what is their role in the soap? So optical brighteners are the chemicals that has conventional product manufacturers use in the detergent formulation to make the laundry look whiter and brighter. They don't actually remove the discoloration or stains or help in the cleansing process at all. They just cover up the enhancing the whiteness of the laundry. So what is their purpose? The purpose of optical brightener is not to discolorize or remove the stains of the cloth. Their purpose is to enhance the whiteness or brightness of the laundry. So now we can study optical brighteners step by step. The first step is, now an integral part of washing powders, optical brighteners are dye stuffs absorbed by textile fibers from solutions, but not subsequently removed in rinsing. They do not remove by rinsing the clothes. They do not remove by rinsing the laundry. What is their purpose? Their purpose is to brighten the clothes. And the second point is that they can convert invisible ultraviolet light into visible light for the blue side of the spectrum, causing the fiber to reflect a greater proportion of visible light and make it appear brighter. So that's how they work, optical brighteners. In the third one, furthermore, since the tone of extra light reflected is on the blue side of the spectrum, this blue violet thing will complement any yellowness present on the fiber to make it look whiter as well as brighter. So how they work, and their purpose is to remove the yellowness which is present in our cloth, and then that can make our cloth more brighter. The chemical structure of optical brightening agents are complicated. Many formulas are trade secrets. Although the action of optical brighteners resembles the old style laundry blowing in some ways, the two methods must not be confused. Number 5. In the old methods, a blue dye or pigment is absorbed into the fiber. The blue tends to absorb yellow light falling on it. Reflecting light reaches in blue. In number 6 point, with glowing, however, the fabric absorbs some of the light falling on it and hence reflects less light than it receives. Thus, the fabric looks whiter, not brighter. So you can take an example of bluing as a blue dye or blue pigment is used that can be added into the cloth to make it look more brighter or clear. In common language, you can take an example of bluing as neel. So neel can be used from decades, and it is old practice of bluing that can be added in small amounts in the water, and that can be used to make the fiber more brighter and whiter. So in the 5 and 6 point, you can see the methods that how that blue dye can work on the laundry or on the clothes. So that's how the optical brighteners can work. Calculating agents. In this slide, you can see how the EDTA person soap. EDTA, thylene diamine tetraacetic acid, or is a sodium salt, has the property of combining with certain metal ions to form more complex structure that locks up or chelates the calcium ion so that it no longer exhibits the ionic properties. So how it works in hot water? The second point, you can see that in hot water, calcium and magnesium ions are thus inactivated and the water is effectively softened. So that has property of EDTA to soften the hot water. In the third point, you can see EDTA can form similar complexes with other metallic ions. So they do not form the complexes with specific metallic ions. They can form more complexes with or similar complexes with other metallic ions. So what is the usage of EDTA in soap? The EDTA can reduce the sticky substances in soap, scum is produced in soap or the sticky substances. So EDTA has property to remove that type of substances and make the soap more softened. Abrasives. The abrasives can be defined as hard material that can be used for polishing, smoothing, and grinding the surface of other materials. You can take an example of abrasives as water-insoluble minerals such as talc, dried mushrooms, earth, silica, marble, volcanic ash, chalk, feldspar, quartz, and sand, are often powdered and added to soap or synthetic detergent formulations. So what are synthetic detergents? The synthetic detergent is any synthetic substance other than soap They can be used as an effective cleanser or functions equally well in the hot water or soft water. It can be called as non-soup cleanser that exerts these effects by lowering the surface tension of aqueous cleansing mixture. In the second point, you can see that abrasives are the nature of the organic substances. The nature of abrasive is organic. You can take an example of abrasive as sawdust. They can be used. So what are sawdust? You can take an example of sawdust as wood pulp, or sawdust can be used as fuel. For those time when there was no refrigerator, the sawdust was used to frozen the substances during the summer. So that's how abrasives can work. So in this slide, I will summarize about the processes which are involved for making the soap and what type of raw materials which are involved for making the soap. So what is soap in chemistry? Soap is a salt of fatty acid. So the consumers mainly use soap as surfactants for washing, bathing and cleaning. But they can also be used in textile spinning and are important components of lubricants. So mostly we use soap for washing, bathing and cleaning purposes. So how these soaps are obtained, which we use for cleaning purposes? Soaps for cleansings are obtained by treating vegetable or animals oils and fats with strongly alkaline solution. So what we need for making the soap, we need animals or plant fats or vegetable oils or fats. We can react that type of fats or oils with strong alkaline solution. We can take the alkali solution of about sodium hydroxide and potassium hydroxide. The second important component for making the soap is fats and oils. And what are fats and oils? The fats and oils are composed of triglycerides, three molecules of fatty acids that can be attached to a single molecule of glycerol. So the alkaline solution, which is often called as lye, although the term lye soaps refers almost exclusively to soap made with sodium hydroxide, so the soaps which are made from sodium hydroxide are called as lye soaps. They bring about a chemical reaction known as punification. So the main reaction which involved for making the soap is punification reaction. So what happened in this type of reaction? In this reaction, the triglycerides fats first hydrolyzed into the free fatty acids, then this combined with alkali to form a crude soap. An amalgam of various soap salts, excess fats or alkali, water and liberated glycerol or glycerin. So what we need fatty acids, and that can be combined with alkali and form the soap and glycerols or glycerin. So the glycerin, which is obtained as a byproduct, they can be remain in soap product as a softening agent or can be isolated for other uses. So we can use glycerin for softening agent of soap, or we can liberate it and use it for further processes. In soap making processes, there are three major raw materials that are used. These raw materials are oils, lye and liquid. Other materials such as colorants, fragrances and additives are also used for added advantages. So besides the major raw materials of soap, we can add colorants, fragrance and additives in the soap to obtain the desired properties in the soap. These raw materials can be added in a soap in the minor quantities, but these are very important to add. Even though these other ingredients are minor, it is important that they are added. Take fragrance for instance. So today we focus on fragrance which are in two forms, natural and synthetics. So we can obtain fragrance by natural ways. We can take fragrance from different types of flowers, fruits, leaves, roots, and we can make fragrance by using the artificial ways. So the natural fragrance are essential oils. These are highly concentrated chemical compounds that can be extracted from various parts of plants. It can be from leaves, roots, flowers, fruits, sap or seeds. So these are 100% natural, and besides adding scent to soap, these are also added. Other beneficial properties of plants such as medicinal for healing purposes. So these synthetic fragrances are man-made. They may be perfumes or fragrance oils. Perfumes are made using essential oils, distillates of essential oils, naturally derived resins and plant compounds together with solvents or fixatives. So fixative is a substance which can be added to keep things in position or stick them together. Although the perfumes are affordable, they do not offer other beneficial properties of plant to the soap other than smell. So there is only difference between the natural made fragrance or synthetic made fragrance is that the natural made fragrance can be used for adding the beneficial properties, and the synthetic fragrance can be used for only the purpose of adding smell to the soap. They do not use for other beneficial properties. So the fragrance, either essential oils or perfumes, are added just after spoonification has taken place. So when the spoonification reaction takes place, we can add the additives or fragrance. You have to solve two assignments. Assignment number one is differentiate between slow lathering soap and hard lathering soaps. Assignment number two is how optical brighteners can work.